We're really happy to have David Barsamian here tonight. He's been producing fantastic radio programs, bringing the voice of the voiceless, the voices we need to hear, to our radio waves since 1978. I heard him speak the other night, and he talked a little bit about his history, and maybe I'm stepping on some of his lines, but everyone told him it would never work, and now he's on a couple of hundred stations around the country with alternative radio. He's authored many books. We thought we were going to be presenting his latest book tonight, Targeting Iran, but I find out that another one has since come out, a series of interviews with Noam Chomsky, What We Say Goes. Both of these are going to be available back there, and who knows, maybe he'll publish another book while we're here this evening. David has been recognized for his work over many decades, his dedicated work. The Institute for Alternative Journalism named him one of its top 10 media heroes. He's also received the ACLU's Upton Sinclair Award for Independent Journalism and the Cultural Freedom Fellowship from the Lannan Foundation, and Peninsula Peace and Justice Center will be bestowing the much sought after Hero of the Revolution Award on David later this year. We're really glad to have him here to talk about a very critical issue, our country's current confrontation with Iran, which seems to grow more serious every day. David went to Iran to research this book thoroughly. He speaks Farsi, so he was able to talk to the people of Iran and get their opinions. He speaks many languages, as a matter of fact. He lectures widely around the world. He's leaving soon on a lecture tour of Pakistan, about a dozen different cities in Pakistan, if there's still a Pakistan when he gets there. But anyway, we are very, very pleased to have him here tonight. Please join me in giving a very warm welcome to David Barsamian.
Good evening, Palo Alto! Woo! It's wonderful to be here, and I really appreciate the opportunity to address you this evening, and particularly to be presented by the Peninsula Peace and Justice Center, an organization that I've long admired and respected, and that has done tremendous work in advancing the cause of peace and justice. So, chapeau bas to the Peace and Justice Center, and long may it thrive. And of course, it will, as long as you're part of it and are actively engaged. I travel all over the United States, and often people ask me, well, what can I do? I'm just one person. Of course, you're just one person. But when you have an organization that you can graft onto, then your power magnifies tremendously. And so these types of grassroots community organizations are providing a space where not only is sanity available, but also I can see great T-shirts, DVDs, and other things there on the back table. So you're very lucky to have such an organization here in Palo Alto. This year, I've been thinking about three writers who have influenced and inspired me, who are no longer with us. The first two you'll readily recognize, Kurt Vonnegut and Molly Ivins. The third one you may not be so familiar with. His name is Hrant Dink. He is an Armenian that was born in Malatya in central Turkey, who was murdered right in the streets of Istanbul, right under his office. In fact, I went to visit his office, Agos office, right in the heart of Turkey's largest city, for speaking the truth. He dared to utter the words that the Turkish state committed a genocide against the Armenian population of Turkey in 1915, and it was continuing atrocities against Turkey's large Kurdish population. And so there is someone who took a risk. And, you know, people are always asking me, well, aren't you afraid? And you know, aren't you worried every time you go to the scareport? That's what I call the airports now. You know, they might pull you over. They may, you know, you may get interrogated. You may be questioned. You may be followed and this and that. And I think it would not be appropriate to adopt a posture of fear, particularly in relation to someone like Hrant Dink, who actually was murdered for his political beliefs. He was assassinated for thought crimes by a Turkish nationalist. And this is an issue that's very close to me. It has informed all of my work. Maybe some of you heard a few months ago I did a program with Robert Fisk, and the testimony of my mother, who was a survivor of that 1915 genocide. If you didn't hear it, if you'd like to have access to it, it's all on my website, alternativeradio.org. And you can hear Alternative Radio actually tomorrow on KALW 91.7 FM. Tomorrow's program is going to be an interview I did in London a couple of months ago with a brilliant man from South Asia, who again, if we had an open media, you would know his name as you would know Frank Sinatra's name, or Tony Bennett, or Britney Spears, or Julia Roberts, or some other such celebrity. His name is Dilip Hero, and he is an expert on the Middle East, and I talked to him about oil, the blood of the earth. So that will be on tomorrow at noon on KALW. And one of the three I mentioned, of course, was Molly Ivins. And Molly and Kurt, for that matter, were great humorists. They always used humor to leaven kind of the political discourse, because, you know, particularly people on the left, they're just way too gloomy. And, you know, the end is near, comrade. It's worse than you think. It's awful. You know, there's no hope. And I think humor is really important. So in the spirit of Kurt Vonnegut and Molly Ivins, I hope you'll indulge me with this breaking news story from... We interrupt this broadcast from Palo Alto, California, to bring you this breaking news story from TIBC, the Truth in Broadcasting Corporation, from our world corporate headquarters in a secure, underground, undisclosed location in Area 51 in Nevada. I'm Dick Veneer, your glib and banal anchor of Facade News, the 24/7 newscast dedicated to keeping you in the dark. We go straight to the surface of a story, and we stay there. No one can challenge our in-shallow reporting. We're dedicated to the highest standards of journalism. Our credos, we deceive, you believe. Unfair and unbalanced. Ladies and gentlemen, an amazing story coming across our news desk from an obscure radio station in Berkeley, calling itself KPFA. They are reporting that George W. Bush has been arrested. The president was found burrowed deep in a spider hole under Hoover Tower with a stash of World Wrestling Federation DVDs and a massive collection of Kenny G and Barry Manilow CDs, all with Iranian serial numbers on them. He was taken into custody by a heretofore unknown group calling itself PALF, the Palo Alto Liberation Front. And according to a so-called spokesperson for this so-called group, one Paul George, he said, "This action, the arrest of Bush, is long overdue. We're dedicated to nonviolence and did not use force on Bush, but we had to act. We could no longer wait for timid Democrats to enforce the law," he said, his voice noticeably rising in anger. And then he stated, "Bush must face justice." Bush was later reported to have defiantly shouted at his captors from PALF, the Palo Alto Liberation Front, "Do you know who I am?" I'm the decider. I am the commander. I am doing God's work on this earth. And God told me to strike Afghanistan, and I did. And God told me to strike Iraq, and I did. And God is telling me to strike Iran, and I will. And then, to everyone's amazement, he burst into tears and said, I want my dad. Bush faces multiple life sentences if convicted for, among other things, violating the U.S. Constitution, the War Powers Act, the Nuremberg Principles, the Geneva Conventions, almost all of them, and the U.N. Charter. If convicted, he will serve his time in Guantanamo. You'll recall the infamous U.S. prison that was returned to Cuban sovereignty late in 2007. He'll have plenty of company there. Already locked up are such luminaries as Dick Cheney, Donald Rumsfeld, Condoleezza Rice, Colin Powell, Paul Wolfowitz, Karl Rove, Douglas Fife, Elliot Abrams, and Alberto Gonzalez. It looks like curtains for Bush. His head was bowed as he was led away by Steph of the Peninsula Peace and Justice Center. She was a blue-helmeted peacekeeper, and Bush was heard whimpering, Dick, 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 where are you, Dick, Dick, Dick? I'm not that Dick. I'm the other Dick. I'm Dick Veneer. You're still glib and banal anchor of Facade News, the 24/7 newscast dedicated to keeping you in the dark. And remember, you watch our news and believe everything, or you're with the terrorists. And now, let's go back to our regularly scheduled program in Palo Alto, California. Stay tuned to Truth in Broadcasting Corporation for updates on this breaking news story. So that's dedicated to Molly Ivins, Kurt Vonnegut, and all of the other great people that make us laugh, like Barbara Ehrenreich and Jim Hightower and others. I think it's really important that we do take care of ourselves. And that's one of the things when people ask me, what can I do? One thing you can do is take care of yourself by, you know, exercising, eating well, and exercising these muscles up here, these gray cells. You know, years ago, I fell off my bike and I broke my shoulder, and I was in a cast for many, many weeks. And then when the cast came off, I had no movement whatsoever, no strength. My muscles had completely atrophied, and so I had to build them up again. And so the brain is like that also. And so we need to exercise and you know, really drink a lot of water, do yoga if you can, and eat good food, and have company. I think company is very important because we all lead lives, I believe this was Thoreau 150 years ago, lives of quiet desperation. We're isolated, we're in front of the TV or we're in front of the computer. Today I found myself riveted to the computer at Ladera in Portola Valley for hours and hours, way beyond what I had anticipated. And it's good, you know, it's good to get information from the computer. It's great to watch DVDs. It's great to listen to alternative radio and making contact. But ultimately, it's about being out in the street. It's about organizing. It's about connecting. There's a wonderful novel by E.M. Forster called Howard's End. And the epigraph is only connect. And it's so important. And if I leave you with anything tonight, it's the hope that you will connect with others here. I'm going back to Boulder tomorrow. Then I go to New York. And as you heard, I'm going to Pakistan. And then from there to India. I hope to visit Iran in February again, and also to go to Lebanon and Syria sometime later this year. So I'm on the move. I'm collecting audio, and I'm presenting that audio to you. And independent media is a very important project in the United States, because without independent voices, basically people are in the dark. That's how Americans are led by the nose, by demagogues sitting in Washington who are telling them that, you know, Grenada is about to occupy the United States. I'm not, that's not a joke. In 1983, Ronald Reagan, I don't suppose anyone here is old enough to remember Ronald Reagan, but there are a couple people maybe. Ronald Reagan announced to the American people that Grenada posed a grave national security threat to the United States. I mean, it's amazing that the press corps, or whatever they call themselves, they're actually stenographers. They're not really journalists anymore. They don't do journalism. They don't investigate. They don't ask real questions. You know, you would think they're really lapdogs with laptops now. Many of them millionaires, if not more, you know, celebrities in their own right, and really have become embedded. What better metaphor can you have for these lapdogs with laptops than being embedded? I mean, I would be embarrassed to be in bed with Dick Cheney, wouldn't you? Or Donald Rumsfeld. I don't find them very attractive people. You know, maybe if, you know, if there was some magic change there, it would be a different proposition. But this is not somewhere where we want to go as independent journalists, yoked to the chariot of imperial power. It's our job to be separate, to have that distance. Not to say we're virtuous and holy and, you know, our caca doesn't smell. Of course it does. I'm glad people know Sanskrit here. I don't have to translate. I know we're being recorded, so I have to watch what I say. Otherwise, the FCC can take away our right to speak. You know, there are certain prescribed words that we cannot now use in radio. One of the classics of American literature is Allen Ginsberg's Howl. We can't broadcast that on the radio. We can't even paraphrase it. We can't read Ulysses by James Joyce. You know, these are the kinds of things that are happening in our country in terms of, you know, limiting free speech. We're worried about ayatollahs in Iran. How about worrying about ayatollahs in Colorado Springs or Oklahoma City, where there are major movements of American Taliban that have grown and expanded, that want to, you know, convert us all to a particular type of Christianity, evangelical, born again, and believing in Armageddon. And incidentally, it is this type of Christianity, which I don't recognize, actually. I grew up in an Armenian Orthodox Christian tradition. I don't recognize the Christianity or the Jesus Christ they describe as their savior. This looks to me like imperialism. This looks like, to me, the wedding of the cross with AK-47s and cluster bombs and F-16s and helicopter gunships. That's not a Christianity I'm attracted to at all. So the independent media is very, very important, and it is growing, making contact, which is a program that has its roots in this community, actually. Peggy Law from Portola Valley, Norman Solomon, who used to live in Boulder Creek at the time, and myself from Boulder, Colorado, so another Boulder, got together, and in 1994, we launched this project. It's a weekly half hour, and it's broadcast on KPFA 94.1 FM every Friday at 1:30. I urge you to listen to it and to support it. We need to grow these media institutions. We need to make them more powerful and stronger. And of course, there's no virtue in my talking about Sean Hannity or Michael Savage or Rush Limbaugh or Glenn Beck or any of these, you know, right-wing gas bags who dominate most of the media. That's not, I don't feel any accomplishment in criticizing them, because what they're saying is just riddled with factual errors and laden with racist stereotypes and other reductive formulaic constructions. It's much more difficult to talk about the New York Times or National Public Radio or the Washington Post or the NewsHour with Jim Lehrer or the Charlie Rose Show. Now I may be coming closer to home with this particular audience. These are highly regarded news outlets, and radio and TV programs. I've written a book about this called The Decline and Fall of Public Broadcasting, and the decline and the fall of public broadcasting has been rather steep over the years. If you, any of you remember when NPR started in 1971, it was quite risk-taking. It wasn't risk-averse. It was risk-taking. And its very first broadcast was a live from Washington, D.C., May Day demonstrations at the Pentagon, unmediated by network anchors, which is now how everything is filtered. Everything is interpreted by very eloquent and articulate and well-versed and verbose anchors who tell you what is going on rather than hearing the voices of the people themselves. And that's one of the goals of independent media, is to bring you those particular voices. And just in the last 2-3 months since I've been traveling so much to the Middle East, I've presented names that would be unknown to you, like Nadir Talebzadeh from Iran, and Mundar Al-Adami from Iraq, and Amal Saad Ghoriab from Lebanon. These are voices that need to be heard. Abdul Bari Atwan, who's the editor of Al-Quds Al-Arabi, the only, practically the only newspaper in Arabic not controlled by the Saudi royal family. We think we have media monopoly problems in the United States. You should try going to Saudi Arabia or other parts of the Arab world, and you'll find an enormous concentration of the media. So one of my jobs, I see, is to uncover those voices, Arundhati Roy from India, Vandana Shiva, Ahmed Rashid from Pakistan, Tariq Ali from Pakistan, and bring them forward, as well as providing you with Howard Zinn and Michael Parenti and Noam Chomsky and Angela Davis and voices like that that you may be more familiar with. It's important that we hear from them in their voices, because they are being represented here by our voices. Just to give you, and one of the reasons the Middle East is so badly misunderstood and so deeply stereotyped and just filled with cliches and platitude is because of the preponderance of representation of voices, mostly white, mostly Christian, who speak for them, them being those, you know, out there. They're all one mass, Iranis, Turks, Pakistanis, Bangladeshis, Indians, Armenians, Kurds, Arabs, etc. An undistinguished blob, and we are to fear the blob because the blob is coming. And I left off a little bit about Grenada in 1983. Let me go back there, because I don't know about you. Next year, we're going to be celebrating the 25th anniversary of the conquest of Grenada. Truly, for any retired military here in the audience, truly one of the great military conquests in U.S. history, something that we could all feel really proud about, you know, overwhelming an island of about several thousand people in the Western Caribbean. Most people can't even find it. And in fact, the corporate media throughout its reporting kept misspelling Grenada as Granada, which is in Spain, only 12,000 miles away. But what's the difference? You're Grenada, Granada, you know, Babada, Dalada, you know, it's all the same. The U.S. conquers Grenada after, you know, Grenada's enormous provocations of the United States. People are laughing now. Again, you're too young in this audience to remember. I mean, I remember the Grenadian Navy blockading both the Atlantic and Pacific coasts, their submarine fleet in the Gulf of Mexico. I mean, the brazenness of this. I mean, this is chutzpah, you know. This is just outrageous. And in Boulder, you know, I'm trying to do radio, and low-flying Grenadian helicopters, you know, buzzing right over the rooftops. We couldn't work. I mean, it was really interfering. So, we're grateful that we defended our country against the New Jewel movement of Maurice Bishop. After the great military conquest, Reagan actually went on national television and announced that we are now standing tall again. Now, I wasn't aware that America was kind of hunchback, but maybe he had some back problem. So that's a direct quote. We are now standing tall again, and the days of America's weakness are now over. Whoa. Again, I wasn't aware that we were particularly weak, particularly after having devastated Laos, Cambodia, and Vietnam, and had launched a major military campaign to crush the FMLN in El Salvador and the Sandinistas in Nicaragua. But all of these little things go down Orwell's memory hole. You'll remember in 1984 in the Ministry of Truth, where the character Winston Smith works, his job was to find the inconvenient facts in the old newspapers and magazines and cut them out and then deposit them in the memory hole, which was a chute that would go right down to the basement of the Ministry of Truth, where there was a vast furnace that, would incinerate all of these inconvenient facts. So it doesn't help. It just wouldn't do, as the Brits say, to raise inconvenient facts. But again, I think that's the job of an independent media. Not to march in their parades, not to wave the flag and salute the great leader and, you know, genuflect in front of power. It's the job of independent media to hold the feet of the powerful, hold that their feet to the fire. And, you know, historically, there have been four estates. This comes from the French Revolution. That is four tiers, three actually in the government, one outside the government. So it would be, you know, the executive, that would be the White House, the first estate. The second estate is the legislature, the Congress. The third estate is the judiciary, the Supreme Court. And the fourth estate has historically been journalism, the press, a free press. Well, it's looking more and more like, to me now, that it's for the state rather than in the fourth estate. It has been very tightly yoked now to imperial power. And there's not enough distance, and there's not enough critical reporting. One of the ways, of course, that the image of the other, be it the Iranian, whoever the enemy du jour is, you know, if it's Noriega, or if it's Gaddafi, or it's Saddam Hussein, or it's Abdel Nasser, you know, they're all compared to Hitler. The countries they rule are compared to Nazi Germany, because this is the benchmark for terror and cruelty and, you know, will attract immediate attention. Anyone who wants to talk to any of these leaders is the equivalent of Neville Chamberlain. Any kind of negotiation is appeasement. And you get into that framework, that's the lexical framework, you know, and Lakoff at Cal has written and talked about this quite a bit, and as, of course, has Chomsky, with whom Lakoff studied at MIT, how language is used to control people's thinking. You're able to manipulate the public mind if you get the public to use the words in the lexicon that are pre-selected. So it's like, have any of you read Thomas Pynchon's novel, Gravity's Rainbow? He says in there, the main task is to get them to ask the right questions, and then the answers will follow. That is, the questions that are not embarrassing. Now, coming to Iran, the enemy du jour, let me show you how images are constructed using extreme left-wing magazines. I know this. I shouldn't be doing this. Let's start with Newsweek. As you know, an extreme left-wing radical magazine. And there is the enemy du jour, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. How dangerous is Iran? And if you look and read inside, very dangerous. You should be afraid. I don't think anyone should go home tonight. Maybe we can just stay here, Paul, and keep everyone safe, because I mean, you're laughing, but a couple of days ago I was off. I was at Del Mar, just north of San Diego, and there were Iranian, you know, submarines right off the coast. You could see the periscopes. You know, you could hear Allah Akbar, you could hear the call to prayer. I mean, again, they're totally shameless. They're we're in great danger. Radical Islam in power, the next nuclear threat. So Iran is very, very dangerous. Be afraid. Then we go to another extreme left-wing magazine. It's called Time. What war with Iran would look like. And here you have actually a cover story in which the targets are defined, what the damage would be, what the collateral damage would be. This is an Orwellism for civilian deaths. And what weapons would be used, the capacity of these weapons, what their throw weight would be, their destructive power. You know, it's kind of like talking about the offensive line of the San Francisco 49ers. You know, the tight end is at 280 pounds and he can block at least two defensive linebackers. And, you know, as you have that kind of discussion around it. Imagine if an Iranian magazine came out in Farsi in Iran saying, what war with America would look like with targets, you know, in Simi Valley and Del Mar and Rancho Santa Fe, you know, really low-class neighborhood slums, etc., Malibu. I think people might be a little upset about that. Now we go to a really highbrow magazine. I actually read it, The Economist. Some of you may see this magazine. They write in complete sentences. They seem to have a command of adverbs and adjectives. Anyone old enough to remember adverbs? No. One person. Okay. She's probably a librarian. Yeah, they existed years ago. See? Now people just feel good. And here you have The Economist, you know, well-edited magazine, Unstoppable, Iran's Nuclear Ambition. Again, with Ahmadinejad pointing his finger with a rocket taking off. And The Economist followed that up. This is a few months ago. Next stop, Iran, with a B-2 stealth bomber. I mean, you know, next stop, Albuquerque. Next stop, Santa Cruz, like a, you know, Grateful Dead tour. Next stop, let's go. Let's keep the war machine going, the permanent war economy. And one of the things I've noticed in magazine covers, maybe someone can do some, this would be a very good study, is why can't they ever find pictures of these designated enemies smiling or, you know, somehow in some playful mood? I guess they must be very unhappy people. I've been watching these magazine covers since the 60s and 70s, and whoever the enemy du jour is always sneering and snarling. You know, and it creates a certain image about them. These are angry people, unlike our people, for example, or, you know, other good people. They're bearded. They're usually brandishing an AK-47 or an RPG. Sometimes they have the keffiyeh, like this, the checkered scarf. And, you know, it does create a certain image of them as the permanent enemy. The New York Times magazine had, just a year ago, a cover story called Islam and the Bomb. Okay, that's an interesting topic, certainly worthy of scrutiny. I've been waiting since the Times published this particular cover story, Islam and the Bomb, for Christianity and the Bomb, Hinduism and the Bomb, Judaism and the Bomb. I think I'm going to be waiting a very, very long time because this serves no useful purpose. Islam now is the radical organizing principle of imperialism, of Washington's domination of the world. It has replaced the Soviet Union as the raison d'etre for a permanent war economy. The United States, I know you're all afraid of Iran. Iran's military budget, incidentally, is $5 billion a year. How much is that? Two of these B-2 bombers is $5 billion. 1 week of carnage in Iraq is $5 billion. Our military budget, which is, again, largely hidden from view because there are all these supplementals, you know, special bills that are passed in Congress, plus the entire intelligence budget we have. It's hard to imagine. I hate to attach American and intelligence together, given the woeful performance of these agencies. There are 16 intelligence agencies telling us about Iran, about Iraq, about Afghanistan, and other, you know, countries around the world. So the actual U.S. military budget is around three-quarters of $1 trillion. But you are supposed to be afraid of Iran. Iran is coming. You know, the rhetoric is exactly as it was in 2002 and 2003, a growing threat. I mean, read Cheney's statements. Read Bush's statements. World War III, Iran, a menace, a growing danger. Also how the, again, how the language is framed when connected with Iran. Every day the headlines, Iran defies, Iran refuses, Iran denies, Iran says no. So if you had just landed from Mars, you would get the impression, first of all, from magazine covers that these are very angry, unhappy people, but also that they are in a constant state of negativity. And by juxtaposition, we are open and embracing and inclusive. We want to, you know, welcome you into our homes. Nothing can be further from the truth, because, in fact, U.S. negotiating posture with Iran is you concede everything I demand a priori in advance, then we'll sit down and I'll have a gun at your head. Now, no self-respecting individual would ever agree to those kinds of terms for discussion, much less a great and proud nation which has thousands of years of history and culture and has produced some of the greatest poetry in the history of the world. This year we're celebrating the 800th anniversary of Jalaluddin Rumi, the great Iranian poet, the Sufi master, translated in more languages and read more than any other poet in the world today. It's a good thing to know about other people's cultures, because one of the aspects of imperial domination is to evacuate the target country of any achievement. The fact that Iran has great architecture, has its own classical music system called Dastgah, great poetry, one of the three or four front rank cinemas in the world today. Iranian cinema, absolutely spectacular. None of this is known, or perhaps only known on the margins, because it just wouldn't do, again, as the Brits would say, to learn that these are people of cultural accomplishment and history. And I like to say that, you know, Iran is not the new kid on the block. It is the block. It's been there. There has been a Persia. There has been something called Persia for 3,000 to 4,000 years, and it's an area of great accomplishment. And we should know about it and respect Iran's history and culture and not dismiss it, you know, as just, you know, Ahmadinejad is Iran. Ahmadinejad is not Iran. We did the exact same thing with Iraq. We said Saddam Hussein is Iraq, Iraq is Saddam Hussein. There are no Iraqi people, there is no Iraqi culture, they're all evil, we must do something about it. The same thing was done in Afghanistan. All of the Afghans were identified as Taliban. There was no distinction made between Mullah Umar and the others. We're doing the exact same thing with Iran today, identifying Mahmoud Ahmadinejad, who incidentally is very unpopular in Iran today. He barely commands 25% of support from the people. He was elected in June of 2005. I'm not going to overstate what Iranian elections are, but, you know, compared to the elections we have here, are we going to be giving lessons to other, you know, other countries? Two millionaire candidates, both graduates of Yale, both members of the Skull and Bone Society, run against each other? These are choices? Maybe, you know, there is, of course, they part their hair on different sides, and one is taller, one is shorter, some wear ties, some have open shirts. I wouldn't be trumpeting American democracy very much, given the choices and the outcomes we've had, and I'm not even talking about outright theft of elections, as we saw in the year 2000. Now, why would Bush want a war with Iran? Well, it's part of the whole imperial grand strategy for the Middle East. The roots of U.S. foreign policy, to be understood, you have to go into the 1940s. During World War II, in fact, right after the Battle of Stalingrad, when it becomes apparent that that Germany will be defeated, Japan had already suffered its first major losses, it had become apparent to policymakers in Washington that the United States was going to emerge after the war as the supreme economic and military power. And Washington asked the Council on Foreign Relations in New York to prepare some documents outlining what the post-World War world would look like. And this was called, and they produced those documents, you can have access to them, it's called Grand Area Strategy. This did for the world what the Monroe Doctrine did for Latin America. It globalized U.S. power. It created commands in every corner of the earth. It defined every area of the globe as strategic and valuable to the U.S. national interest, from tin in Bolivia, to copper in Chile, and most importantly, the oil of the Middle East. In that document, the Middle East oil reserves are defined as the greatest strategic prize in the history of the world, and it is the role of the United States to dominate that prize. Now, there was a slight problem for the imperial designers of the post-World War II world. There were still the old empires to deal with. The French and the British still were around in that neighborhood that we now coveted so rapaciously, very much as the Belgians wanted the Congo for its ivory. The French were not really that much of a problem because they were in Lebanon and Syria and there wasn't really much oil to speak of there. It was the British that posed the problem because the British had Iraq, they had Kuwait. Kuwait was an outright British colony, broken off from Iraq in 1920. The British had Iran, basically, although there was Russian first and then Soviet kind of a hegemony in the northern part of Iran. And the United States had to deal with this. And now this is where Iran kind of comes into the picture. How to get the British out of Iran and get U.S. in there. In the late 1940s, Iran is a destitute, impoverished country. All of its oil is controlled by one European, British-based corporation, actually the forerunner to what is now BP. You know, if you watch the News Hour with Jim Lehrer, you'll know that British Petroleum is an environmentally friendly green company. I mean, if you believe that, please see me afterwards for some beachfront property in Boulder that I'd love to make available to you. Also, I have the Brooklyn Bridge on my property, spanning right across the deck of, you know, that's right on the ocean there. Lovely, lovely property. And the British controlled all of the oil and were expatriating all of the profits out of Iran. In 1951, democratically elected, moderate, lower D, Democrat, Mohammad Mossadegh is elected as Prime Minister of Iran. And he said, you know, this is not fair, this is not just. Why should the British be getting all of the profits and our people are suffering? So he decided to nationalize Iran's oil. This sent shockwaves, first through London, where Churchill was the Prime Minister, and then, you know, to Washington, because this could be a very bad precedent. Now you have the people, the slaves on the plantation, rising up and saying, we own the manor house. We should be living in the manor house. Why are we living in the slave barracks with barely anything to eat? So this was, of course, a theme throughout post-U.S. history, post-World War II U.S. history, the threat of a good example. Whether it's a democracy, middle of the road, whether it's left-wing like Allende in Chile or the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, it doesn't matter. There cannot be any independent formations outside of Washington's framework of power. That's what Kissinger called it, the overall framework of power, where you have police headquarters in Washington and local cops on the beat like Iran under the Shah, Turkey, Israel performs that function in the Middle East, and NATO now, which has become like the French Foreign Legion. As far as I know, NATO was not attacked on September 11th. Nevertheless, NATO is occupying Afghanistan. A very interesting geopolitical development, and as far as my knowledge, no one has commented on this, that NATO has now become an adjunct of the, has become a Praetorian Guard of the U.S. Empire. To be sent where U.S. troops are not available, you send NATO, just like the Foreign Legion, another mercenary organization. So Churchill, Eisenhower then becomes President of the United States. Churchill was unable to persuade Truman to do anything about Iran because I don't think Truman saw it as something threatening U.S. interests. But Eisenhower was easy pickings, particularly when Churchill came up with a new ploy to hook the Americans into attacking Iran, into overthrowing the democratically elected government of Mohammad Mossadegh. And that was the red car, the red card. Churchill convinced Eisenhower that Mossadegh, who was this very mild-mannered man, in fact, very naive. First of all, he was educated in France, what more can I say, at the Sorbonne. So he had obvious, you know, intellectual disadvantages. Sometimes people don't know what the Sorbonne is, and I have to tell them. It is the premier university of France, if not in all of Europe, and anyone would give their eye teeth to get in it. So I kind of, you know, say that sarcastically. But with American audience, you never know. I mean, the depth or the height of ignorance sometimes is so staggering, you can take nothing for granted. Even when I was in the Dallas-Fort Worth airport some months ago, and I was wearing this particular T-shirt, Stop the War Machine. It comes from a group in Albuquerque that I work with, stopthewarmachine.org. They put out this T-shirt to raise money for their demonstrations and for their activities. New Mexico is one of the most militarized states in the United States. If you're thinking of moving there, it has a vast weapon, two major weapons labs in Sandia Mountains right outside of Albuquerque, and north of Santa Fe is the Los Alamos weapons lab. These labs, along with Livermore, not too far from here, are where your weapons of mass destruction are being designed, where they're being enhanced, where they're becoming smarter and sleeker and better all the time. And it was my misfortune, or first of all, it was my good fortune that day to have spoken in Denton, Texas, where there's a peace group, believe it or not. This is not Austin. This is an hour north of Denton. There are peace and justice people everywhere. Houston, San Antonio, I've spoken to them, and of course, you would expect in Austin. So I go to Denton, give this talk. It was 11 o'clock, great. I kept the T-shirt on, which turned out was not a brilliant idea, because I walked into the Dallas airport wearing Stop the War Machine, and almost immediately, I noticed people staring at me very intently, you know, kind of like the glare of Ahmadinejad. You know, I didn't feel any friendliness or kindness from these stares. They were looking very, very hard at me. And, you know, I know it couldn't have been I know my limitations. It wasn't my physique. And also to my distress, at that very moment, as I enter the main terminal, There are hundreds of U.S. troops there. The 10th Mountain Division from Fort Drum, New York, has just been redeployed from Iraq, and they're coming through the Dallas International Airport. So now the stares that I was getting on the security line and when I came into the building were turning into glares, and I soon found myself surrounded by some of these warriors, 17, 18, 19 years old, a lot older than most of you here in this audience. And I noticed they were also looking at the back of this particular T-shirt, which says, "I was right about the military-industrial complex." Now, when I said you can never underestimate the ignorance of the American people, several of these soldiers, our defenders of freedom, of course, asked me who was Ike. All right. It's hard to make up these anecdotes. And it's not a made-up. I mean, this actually happened. And I had to explain that he was a five-star general, commander of all Allied troops in Europe, leader of the D-Day invasion of Normandy. They had heard of that. So now they were like, wow, heavy. Heavy dude, man. And then, the clincher, two-time Republican president of the United States. But then this other thing, military-industrial complex, what's that about? Well, in his farewell address on January 17th, 1961, as he's about to exit the White House and Kennedy's about to come in, he warns the country for the first time that there is this growing cancer inside the United States. And he defined it as a military-industrial complex. In the initial draft, by the way, which we have copies of, it was the military-industrial congressional complex. And his aides said, you're going to have to play golf with these guys. You owe them a lot of favors. You're going to, this won't do. You can get away with military industrial, but you've got to strike congressional. And he did, in fact. Today, of course, it would be congressional. I would add media and educational complex as well, with some notable exceptions. That's really where power lies in the United States, with the military, industrial, media, congressional, educational complex. The companies that rule, that really define the economy, are Lockheed Martin and Boeing and Northrop Grumman and Honeywell and General Dynamics. You have stocks in those companies? Maybe some of you do. And General Electric and Sikorsky and the Carlyle Group and ExxonMobil and Chevron Texaco and ConocoPhillips. I've just named, maybe the top 10 outside of Walmart and, a few things like that of the Fortune 500 companies. These are some of the richest companies in the world because war pays. The military-industrial complex pays big dividends for these corporations. They're very capital intensive and not labor intensive. They generate huge amounts of profits, and like in Iraq and in other places, Afghanistan, many of these contracts that we, the people, give to them are cost plus. Any contractors in the audience? When you hear the word cost plus, you pass out in joy. It means you pass on all incidental costs that may occur. There's a flood, the roof collapses, the iron is not delivered, the steel is defective, it's sent, everything is added on, and that's why we have all of these boondoggles in Iraq and Afghanistan, and if they get their way in Iran as well. So just to get back to Eisenhower, and I know you're pressed for time, and I've been asked to limit my remarks to 3.5 hours. I understand tomorrow's a work day. Some of you, work, and you'll have to leave. So I'll try and speak a little faster and compress even more information. We're talking about Eisenhower, the military-industrial complex. If he were alive today, he wouldn't recognize the country he was describing in 1961. So firm is the grip of that military-industrial complex, and so underreported it is, so hidden is it from view. How many of you know about the 49ers being shut out by the Seahawks on Monday Night Football? How many of you know about Britney Spears' numerous problems with, her keeping custody of her children. How many of you know about the Paris Hilton video on the internet? How many of you know about Michael Vick and Michael Jordan and Michael Jackson and the, you remember the, what was that called? The malfunctioning wardrobe at the Super Bowl. So I'm sorry to offend some of the younger people in the audience. You remember that? Janet Jackson and Justin Timberlake? I mean, there was a big brouhaha. There was a congressional investigation the next day. There's been no congressional investigation about the missing $9 billion in Iraq or the missing 200,000 weapons or all of the cost overruns and all of the incomplete projects that dot now that incredibly devastated country. So Eisenhower, okay, let's connect the dots. Eisenhower is sitting in the White House in 1953. Churchill convinces him, totally lying, that Mossadegh is a communist. You have to do something. Now, Eisenhower says, okay, he's got the Dulles brothers right there, CIA Director Allen Dulles and John Foster Dulles as Secretary of State. Two professional, hysterical, extreme anti-communists who saw Reds everywhere. You know, this was the height of the Red Scare. The communists were coming, they were in your bathroom, they were in your closet, they were underneath your mattress, the Reds controlled the universities, the media. You all remember that. I mean, maybe it was a little exaggerated. And so Eisenhower was receptive. And he sends Kermit Roosevelt to Tehran, Teddy Roosevelt's grandson, to organize a coup. It's called Operation Ajax. And it's run out of the U.S. Embassy in Tehran. This is where, we recruit editors and journalists from the Iranian media to come in, to get money, essentially, paid off, to plant articles in the Iranian media that Mossadegh's a communist, Iran is going to become a Soviet colony, you're going to have to speak Russian, you won't be able to practice Islam, Iran will be a slave of the Soviet Union, and, you know, yada, 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 as the kids say. Also recruited were high-ranking members of the Iranian military. There's a very sophisticated term for this, but I'll just show you what it is. Now, this should be a wad of $100 bills. Unfortunately, it's mostly singles. But this is how we spread democracy and freedom around the world. This is how democracy is spread in Iraq, in Anbar province. That is how so-called Sunni tribal sheikhs are paid off. Incidentally, that's another British colonial construction that's being repeated, as if we haven't learned anything from British imperialism. It is money walks, as Bob Dylan, not only walks, as Bob Dylan says, it swears. And so Iranian military officers are recruited, stay in your barracks, don't do anything. And the coup takes place. Mossadegh is just overwhelmed. I mean, he doesn't know what's going on. He actually admired the United States and naively believed, probably because he went to the Sorbonne, that the U.S. was different from the old imperialisms that he was familiar with. Little did he know. He's overwhelmed, overthrown, under house arrest. The Shah, who's in exile in Rome, is flown back on a CIA plane, placed on the peacock throne where he rules for the next 25, 26 years as a major instrument of U.S. power in the Middle East. Some would call him a puppet or a stooge. Maybe that's too unkind. But without doubt, he was a major agent of U.S. power in the region. This is all described in great detail in Targeting Iran, the new book that just came out. Now, the coup had three important ramifications. And then we'll jump to the modern period because I kind of have a feeling that you want to hear about what's going on today and the threat of war, which is very real, of course. The coup, first of all, ended British power in Iran, a major U.S. objective as defined by the imperial grand strategy prepared by the Council on Foreign Relations experts in the 1940s. So this was an enormous triumph for the United States, sidelining British power and bringing the U.S. in. The Shah is totally beholden now to the United States because basically they saved his ass. They saved his throne. They put him back on the throne, and he reciprocated by buying tens of billions of dollars of U.S. weaponry and also providing police services in the Gulf when necessary. For example, when Washington was busy killing Cambodians, Laotians, and Vietnamese in the 1960s and 1970s, they didn't have a lot of spare troops, and there was an uprising in Dhofar in Oman, and Washington called up the Shah and says, send your Iranian troops, take care of that rebellion. And he did. He did what he was told, or what he was asked. So there were payoffs. So that was one big achievement of the coup, in quotes. The end of British power in Iran, the introduction of the United States as the key player. The other thing was, of course, access to Iranian oil by U.S. oil corporations. I hate to inform people here, but oil is a major interest of U.S. power and U.S. elites. They can't openly say that. I know people are shaking their heads. And there's been, you know, a lot of study of this. You know, very deep research has been done. Some people think it's pomegranates or watermelons or cantaloupes. But I've looked at this issue very closely, and it seems that oil, in fact, is the defining factor that drives the policy. The 53 coup also becomes a template for all subsequent CIA coups. You can understand nothing about what happens in Guatemala or the Dominican Republic or Indonesia or Chile or any of the other countries that the United States either invades or overthrows without understanding the Iranian template. This is how it's done. You recruit people from the local military, you pay off the media, you put black propaganda into the media, and you whip up, you know, enormous popular demand for regime change. They're doing the exact same thing today again in Iran. Tens of millions of dollars directed to creating fictitious stories in the Iranian media. And the other thing, of course, was blowback. The first time this term is used is in reference to the 1953 coup. After the CIA conducts an operation, they have a post-ops report. It looks very much like the San Francisco Chronicle description of yet another 49er defeat. You know, the coach should have changed the quarterback in the third quarter. He should have kicked a field goal instead of running on fourth down. He should have made this play when this was, it's just like that. Coulda, shoulda, woulda, this worked well, this didn't work well. For the first time, the term blowback is used. So whoever prepared that report was quite sagacious, one must say, in retrospect. He or she recognized that this coup could have ramifications down the road. It could have the negative consequences of U.S. covert operations. And it's the first time the term is used. And there's a direct connection between 1953 and the Islamic Revolution of 1979. Now, I do want to jump now, compressing lots of information, the Islamic Revolution, the hostage crisis, U.S. support for Saddam Hussein throughout his eight-year war against Iran, a clear violation of international law and the UN Charter, no matter what you may have thought of the Ayatollahs and the mullahs in Iran. It was a sovereign state. It wasn't like Saddam Hussein was a Democrat. Wasn't he Hitler on the Tigris? Well, he was until the U.S. said, now we got another Hitler. We'll move the Tigris, you know, to the mountains of Tehran. So, you know, this is the shell game. And again, you know, since we live in the USA, the United States of amnesia, as Gore Vidal says, there's no memory. And the media do not remind people of these things. The media do not remind people that the United States enabled Saddam Hussein throughout the 1980s, during his worst atrocities, including the use of chemical weapons against Iranian troops. We were absolutely silent. We weren't silent when Saddam Hussein used those weapons against Iraqi Kurds. Then we were virtuous. Then we were on our high horse. This shows you the barbarity of, you know, of after the fact, of course, just before the invasion in 2003. This was used as justification. How many times did Bush say he used chemical weapons on his own people? How many times did you hear that? Over and over again. It was a constant propaganda trope. It was true. Those weapons were delivered by Bell helicopters given to Saddam Hussein by the United States. The weapons ingredients were also as a result of the U.S. giving ammonia and chloride and other chemical ingredients, supposedly for use in agriculture, but were turned into use into poison gas, biological weapons, and chemical weapons. Now, the Iranians are well aware of this. You know, these are not, as I said, these are not new kids on the block. They know exactly what's going on. They know about the shooting down of an Iranian jetliner in 1988 in July, 290 Iranians massacred. Not a word from Washington. Not only not a word, the commander of the U.S. destroyer was given a medal, and George Bush, when later confronted, probably by a non-American journalist, I can't imagine an American journalist asking this question, because the Iranian airliner was flying in international airspace, someone asked him, well, it's clear that, you know, this plane was not threatening the U.S. warship in the Persian Gulf. Why was it shot down? And Bush declared, and every Iranian will quote you the words verbatim, I don't care what the facts are, I will never apologize for the United States of America. Yeah, well, Zeke. Yeah, great. We're, you know, what we say goes, like what Chomsky says. That's the basic tenet of U.S. foreign policy. What's yours is mine, what's mine is mine. Your resources happen to be in your country. That's just an accident of geography. They actually belong to me. Not to me, of course, but to the corporations that I service. That is the classic Marxist description of the president of, whoever the president of the United States is the chief executive officer of the Fortune 500. He is the, you know, carrying out the policies for the economic benefit of these large corporations who get these people elected. It is the best system money can buy. And if you really, again, to understand how this works, you know, all you have to do is watch 10 minutes of any episode of The Sopranos, and you'll know how U.S. foreign policy works. You step out of line, you're dead. You kiss my hand, you bow before me, I'm your man. I'll take care of you. You'll get a cheesecake on your wedding anniversary. I'll send you flowers on your birthday. Your kids need money for your college tuition. No problem. Check in the mail. I'll take good care of you. The moment you step out of line, it's lights out. And that's how it is. That's the pattern. It has nothing to do with left, right, or center. You see any examples, the threat of independent development. That's why they hate Chavez in Venezuela. Why do you think they despise him? Because he's saying no to Washington. And Morales is saying no in Bolivia. And Correa is saying no in Ecuador. And Castro has for decades been saying no. And Damascus is saying no. And Tehran is saying no also. And so they are classified as rogue states. They must be dealt with by the Godfather. It's a good way to understand really existing U.S. foreign policy, not the fantasies that are spun out by these myth-makers about freedom and democracy and liberty. You know, that's for bedtime stories. There's very little evidence to support those kinds of assertions. It's about power, it's about domination, and it's about control. Now, those are not flattering things to say about one's country. I'm sorry to report what, in my view, is, and my analyses of the actual workings of U.S. foreign policy, not the fantasies, but its actual, ingredients, what makes it up and what drives it, control, domination, oil. Even Alan Greenspan, one of their own, you know, in his autobiography, just said, of course the Iraq War was largely about oil. And John Abizaid, right here in Stanford, very recently said the Iraq War was about oil. Iran has oil and natural gas, has the second largest oil and natural gas reserves in the world. It's a country of 70 million people. One-third of the population is under the age of 30, so it's a very young population. 65% of all college and university students are women. Women are very... I tell this to audiences in the United States, and I see the eyebrows go up. If a Saudi woman were to die today and wake up in Iran tomorrow, she thinks she has gone to heaven. That's how different Iran is compared to Saudi Arabia, which in our Orwellian discourse is described as a moderate state. This is one of the most, it is the most misogynist, homophobic, fundamentalist regime on the face of the earth. It created the Taliban. It funded the Taliban in Pakistan and Afghanistan. 15 of the 19 hijackers were from Saudi Arabia. Not an Iraqi among them. Not an Afghan among them. Not an Iranian among them. In fact, the day after September 11th, wide demonstrations all over Iran, Iranians came out holding candles in solidarity with the victims of September 11th. I didn't see that widely reported here in the United States, that Iranians had great compassion. The president of Iran at the time, Mohammad Khatami, said that this was an atrocity that was inexcusable, that had nothing to do with Islam, that anyone who would try to connect Islam with this kind of an attack did not know what Islam was, and those kinds of things. So the September 11th, of course, then was used to ratchet up an attack on Iraq and Afghanistan. Iran was very helpful to the United States in the attack on Afghanistan. And this is one thing you need to know about the propaganda going down, because clearly they're kind of giving up on the weapons issue. They're looking for an excuse to attack Iran. And the weapons issue looks like a non-starter because al-Baradei is not playing ball with them. The one person who is in Iran, who actually carries out the inspections and knows what he's talking about, he is a Nobel Prize winner, 2005. I know he's an Arab, so, you know, that makes him suspect. Joke. He's a very honorable man. I trust him, and I wish we would have trusted Hans Blix in 2002 and 2003, and the Iraq would not be in the state of carnage and destruction that it is today. And al-Baradei says, there's nothing there. We're still looking, but there is nothing there. I believe him. I don't believe Dick Cheney. I don't believe Bob Gates. I don't believe George Bush or Condoleezza Rice or any of the other hawks who want some kind of military confrontation with Iran. Now, I kind of think they've given up on the weapons. What are they going to use? They're going to find, there's going to be an incident inside of Iraq in which there are American casualties, and you're going to find Bush going on television announcing, you know, surrounded by flags, of course, with a, you know, very grim visage, saying, my fellow Americans, I regret to inform you that 26 of our brave men and women in uniform have been killed, and we know that Iranian weapons were responsible. Iranian serial numbers were found on the bombs. We have a confession, solicited under enhanced interrogation techniques. We don't do torture, waterboarding, surfboarding, skateboarding. Isn't it interesting how they make this like a sport? Waterboarding. Why don't you speak in English? How about drowning? Does that make it clear? I mean, waterboarding, let's all waterboard after the lecture. You know, maybe we'll just go up and down the street here and have a grand time. Drowning, you know, when years ago, I don't like to brag, but years ago I interviewed Confucius. It was one of my earlier interviews. I see some people are very skeptical in this audience. I don't have the kind of obedience or respect that someone of my stature should engender. But it was one of my earlier interviews. You can imagine what tape recorders were like then. And I had great difficulty reaching Confucius, by the way. That problem was I couldn't speak any Chinese, and he didn't know English. Finally, I got in touch with Chomsky, and he had the contacts. So, you know, I interviewed, and it was a tough interview. Imagine you can't speak the person's language, and he can't speak your language. And I didn't know how to address him as, is it Mr. Confucius or Confucius-san? So I didn't even go there. I didn't mention his name at all. But I asked him, Mr. Confucius, what would be the first thing you'd do if you ruled a country? Well, he laughed. He said, of course, that I'm not interested. I'm a mendicant. I'm a philosopher. But I said, well, just for, you know, supposition's sake, what would be the first thing? He said, the first thing I would do would be the rectification of language. Again, going back to that earlier point I made about the control of vocabulary. If you seize the lexical high ground, then you can actually determine the outcomes. So when you have a debate today about Iran on the McNeil, it's no longer McNeil, the NewsHour with Jim Lehrer, or on Morning Edition with Cokie Roberts or Renee Montaigne, woeful journalists who know nothing about the Middle East, who know nothing about Iraq, Afghanistan, Iran, its history, Islam, Islamic civilization, Arab civilization. I mean, it's truly staggering the lack of information that you know they don't have at their fingertips. And so the discussions are, how should we attack Iran? Is now the good time to do it? And then the debate is, no, now is not the good time. U.S. troops are overextended. We should wait. No, and the other person, no, now's the time. Attack now. It'll be good. Nowhere is war crime mentioned. Nowhere is the U.N. Charter mentioned. Nowhere are the Geneva Conventions mentioned. These all disappear. In fact, I mentioned elite media. Right? The New York Times. I read it every day. It's a very important newspaper. And indeed, if you go down to paragraph 27, on page 14, you actually find kernels and nuggets that are very, very, very valuable. In 70 editorials the New York Times did from September 11th, 2001, on Iraq, until March 20th, 2003, 70 editorials. In not one editorial on Iraq did the Times ever mention international law, the UN Charter, or the Nuremberg Principles. That any attack on a country that is not threatening you is a grave breach of international law. And this is why the Germans were hung at Nuremberg, because of the planning and waging of aggressive war. This is completely out of public discourse. It wouldn't do to talk about it on All Things Considered or Morning Edition or any of these other programs. So again, New York Times, one other thing, I can't resist. I'm on a roll. You remember Jason Blair? He was a New York Times reporter who fabricated, unlike our politician, he made things up. You know, he said, I went to Philadelphia, I talked to somebody there who didn't exist. I went to Nyack, New York. I visited a restaurant there which didn't exist. You know, these kinds of things. And it became a big scandal. You know, heads rolled in the New York Times. Two main editors were fired. The New York Times published a 14,000-word mea culpa, a front-page story that ran inside for page after page, parsing every single word Jason Blair ever wrote for the New York Times. You know, he said this, it was a lie. He claimed this, it was a fabrication. He said he did this, there's no evidence for it. Every single word, down to the and to and because and with and and. Deeply, deeply deconstructed. I mean, a masterwork of kind of investigative journalism of its own accord. Now, that was a 14,000-word article. And, okay, Jason Blair lied. Nobody died. There weren't big consequences. I mean, it's not an honorable thing to lie. I know no one in this audience has ever lied. I certainly have never lied. So we're in elite company here. But nothing came of it that was really catastrophic in nature. Countries weren't destroyed. Budgets weren't burst. Reputations were not smashed, as our reputation is today in the rest of the world. The Times, shortly after that, published a mea culpa about its coverage of the Iraq War. Where did it appear? Page 10. Where on page 10? Below the fold. How many words? 1,100. And a consistent use of the passive voice. This is something that Orwell talks about in his terrific essay, Politics and the English Language. If you want to deflect agency and responsibility, you use the passive voice. Mistakes were made. It was a tragic outcome. People died. a village burned. Civilization was wiped out. So there's no agency. Throughout this article, you did not learn that it was Judith Miller and Michael Gordon who were the conveyor belts for all of the propaganda that the Times published to justify an attack on Iraq. Michael Gordon is still at the Times. He's still writing articles about Iranian weapons in Iraq. He hasn't learned his lesson. He also wrote a book called Cobra 2. He's, a highly, highly respected journalist. Judith Miller is now working at the Wall Street Journal. I mean, these people should be in some kind of gulag for journalists, or some kind of fat farm, where we just get them out of sight. It's amazing. That's a very instructive, when you have this juxtaposition, the Jason Blair mea culpa and the Iraq war mea culpa. Look at the impact the Iraq war has had on Iraqis alone, a country destroyed, 1 million dead, 2 million wounded, injured, 3 million internal refugees, 3 million external refugees, a complete collapse of the educational and healthcare systems, which were the best in the Middle East, a complete collapse of water and sanitation. There is now cholera in Iraq, in 9 of Iraq's 18 provinces that didn't exist for decades. It had been eradicated. Children are dying because of diarrhea and dysentery and other waterborne diseases. All because of the collapse of Iraq. So that kind of lying had big consequences. Now, will there be an attack on Iran? I think they're looking for an excuse, and they're going to probably find it in Iraq. But the consequences of such a military adventure, I think, will be drastic and dire. Just on something that touches all of you, the price of gasoline, the $3.50 you're paying now, you'll look back on that with nostalgia if there's a war with Iran. You'll say, wow, $3.50, remember how cheap it was? God, what a bargain. I wish I was, had many, many tanks full of gas, saved up to use it. Iran is not going to just take it on the chin and be, humiliated by the United States, with some kind of aerial bombardment. That's what they have in mind. In fact, in the supplemental budget that just passed, yet another supplemental budget, another $150 billion down the sewer hole. Of course, it's making Halliburton's day, it's making Bechtel's day, it's making Lockheed Martin and Northrop Grumman's day, not to mention Blackwater, Triple Canopy, DynCorp, and the other mercenary organizations inside of Iraq. The latest supplemental bill, $190 billion requested, an extra almost $100 million to modify B-2 stealth bombers so that they can carry a 30,000-pound bomb called MOP, Massive Ordnance Penetrator, MOP, Massive Ordnance Penetrator. And the MOP is an advanced form of this bunker buster. It is a near-nuclear weapon. It is just a grade or two below what an atomic weapon would be in terms of its destructive capacity. And we learn that the administration requested it in its justification to the brave Democrats, who are, of course, the opposition party that's challenging Bush, with such vigor and with such integrity, not on all of them. They sign off on all of these bills, while one side of the mouth, I'm saying, we're against the war. On the other side of the mouth, they're enabling the war. They're having it both ways. Very much like Ahmadinejad has it both ways with the Holocaust. I mean, he too is a hypocrite. Hypocrisy is not limited to the United States. It's a worldwide phenomenon, by the way. There's all this brouhaha about the Holocaust. Ahmadinejad frequently asked the question, which many in the Middle East ask. Iran is not an Arab country, by the way, but it's different language group, different phenotype, etc. Ahmadinejad says, as many people in the Middle East ask, why should Palestinian Arabs, Muslims, and Christians, why should they pay for the crimes of Europeans, white Europeans, in their annihilation of the Jews? Now, that's a I think that's a very interesting question, I mean, philosophically. But at the same time, he hosts conferences in Tehran saying that this crime, which he's talking about, never happened. So he's trying to have it both ways. That's what I mean by this. You know, he's not the brightest bulb on the block. And so this new weapon is in response, Bush tells Congress, to, quote, urgent operational need from theater commanders. Now, is this going to be used against Iraq? Probably not. Clearly, this is intended for Iran. And so the march toward war continues inexorably. There are three aircraft carrier battle groups positioned right off the Persian Gulf. How many aircraft carriers does Iran have, by the way? Can anyone say zero? You know, they have, and they, you know, I've seen the Iranian Navy. I should report on it. You know, there's kayaks, canoes, rowboats, refurbished yachts, and some diesel submarines that they got from the Soviet Union. You know what a diesel submarine is? It is so loud that if it were in the bay over here, where's the bay? If it were in the bay over here, you could hear it in this room without sonar. That's how loud those diesel submarines are. But nevertheless, you know, be afraid. Three aircraft carrier battle groups positioned right off the coast of Iran. The country is surrounded. There are U.S. troops in Iraq, U.S. troops in Afghanistan, U.S. Air Force bases in Central Asia. And, you know, the Mediterranean, of course, is, why do we call it the Mediterranean anymore? We should call it one of the Great Lakes. I mean, it's completely controlled by the U.S. Fleet. And so Iran is surrounded, but Iran has assets. Iran can fight back, and Iran will fight back if these warlords in Washington, and that's what they are, warlords that should be impeached. And I believe that Nancy Pelosi made a grave mistake when she announced in November of 2006 that impeachment is off the table. Impeachment should be on the table. The crimes of this particular administration are so unambiguous and so non-controversial. I mean, anyone who has any familiarity with national or international law would ask the question, how come there's no impeachment hearings going on? Why isn't this happening? Anyone old enough to remember Clinton in 1998? What was that about? Were countries destroyed? Were a million people killed? Were hundreds of billions of dollars, maybe trillions of dollars, wasted in that scandalous episode? So I think this was a huge mistake by Speaker Pelosi. I've been making the joke, you know, I hope she got something for it, maybe a Starbucks certificate or a year's supply of, you know, free downloads from iTunes, or maybe a, you know, Neiman Marcus, you know, gift certificate. You don't give away a card like that and not get anything in return. What was she thinking? The one mechanism you have, any state has, or any citizenry has, to hold officers of the state to, when they commit crimes, to hold them accountable, is impeachment. That is the one mechanism, that's the one tool we have, legal tool. And for her to remove it from discussion and off the table, I want to see this table, by the way. Maybe there's a lot of money underneath it. What is this table? Is it made of oak? Is it of teak, of ash, or what? They're always talking about, you know, it's off the table or on the table. And with Iran, you'll notice every single Democratic candidate, with a few honorable exceptions, says that the military option is on the table with Iran. Not off the table. On the table. So they're all talking about it, except for a couple of them. Now, and Pelosi, again, I'm sorry, I know she's a grandmother, she's the first woman Speaker of the House. You know, many of you may even know her or have been to, you know, events with her. in the spring of this year, in yet another one of these Iraq war bills, you know, supplementals, to kind of hide the actual money spent, there's a line in there that says, the Bush administration cannot attack Iran without congressional approval. There it is, clear English. It sounds like a reasonable thing. After all, there is a constitution which enables and only permits the Congress to declare war, you know, something it has surrendered on numerous occasions in recent years. The bill passes. We look at the bill the next day. Sentence gone. I guess there was some invisible ink, or maybe we were really deluded or drank the Kool-Aid. Maybe it was never there. It was there. It's gone when the bill passes. We learned from The Nation magazine that Speaker Pelosi and Majority Leader Reid came under tremendous pressure from AIPAC to remove that particular sentence from the bill. That is the American-Israel Public Affairs Committee. I have not investigated this. This was reported by The Nation. But it seems plausible that elements in Washington want military action against Iran, and therefore lobbied successfully to have that removed. Iran has assets in Afghanistan that can fight the United States. Half the population speaks Farsi, the national language of Iran, and about, I'd say, at least a quarter of the rest of the population certainly understands the language. 65% of Iraq is Shia, which is the main form of Islam in Iran, where 90% of the population is Shia. The chief Ayatollah of Iraq is an Irani, Ayatollah Sistani. The main pilgrimage centers for Iranian Shias are located in Iraq, the shrine of Imam Ali at Najaf and Imam Hussein in Karbala. At any given time, there are hundreds of thousands of Iranians visiting in Iraq, not just for religious pilgrimages. There are many family ties, kindred groups that are connected between these two countries, which have a long border and a long history of interaction and interchange. So easily the southern part of Iraq passes through an area which is almost entirely Shia. That's where the supply lines are from Kuwait. Those supply lines could be cut. The Iran sits astride the Strait of Hormuz, which is a 30-mile wide narrow gap separating the Persian Gulf and the Indian Ocean. Many of the world's oil tankers pass through the Strait of Hormuz. It would not be difficult for Iran to either block the strait with mines or actually sink ships. They have surface-to-air missiles. So Iran, I'm saying, is not Grenada. Iran is not a banana republic. You know, you hit me, I'm down, I don't do anything, I kiss your feet. They are not going to kiss Washington's feet. They will not be bullied. People are very, very proud, and they're nationalistic. And I want to end with this note, because every Iranian I spoke to, even those that hated the regime, even those who have suffered because of the regime in Tehran, the regime of the mullahs, like Shireen Ebadi, who the Iranian woman who won the Nobel Prize in 2003. She lost her job because of these mullahs. When Ahmadinejad came in 2005, he fired her. So under the previous president, Mohammad Khatami, there was a little more space for women and for some pluralism in the Iranian polity. But now they say, we are under attack, we are under siege from the United States. We, every time bellicose rhetoric is generated in Washington, there's a clampdown in Iran. People are arrested, dissidents are imprisoned. There are major human rights violations in Iran. This is very clear. We're not talking about an idyllic regime here. But everyone that I spoke to said it would be an enormous mistake if the United States were to launch an attack on Iran, because people will rally around the flag. They'll rally around the country, not a regime that they have little tolerance for or liking for. Maybe a quarter of the population supports Ahmadinejad, who incidentally is not the leader of Iran. He's number two. The leader of Iran is the supreme Ayatollah. Every decision that is made in Iran is filtered through the supreme Ayatollah. So Ahmadinejad is the face of the regime, but the actual power lies somewhere else. It lies with the clerics. And just to give you one example, when I went to the University of Tehran, there's a lot of unemployment in Iran. Most of the young people, when they get trained, and it's a very highly educated population, and literacy is very, very high as well, they have to go to the Gulf. They're all looking to Dubai or to Abu Dhabi for jobs because there's very little work being produced in Iran today, unless you want to work for the security forces, like the United States. And I talked to the students, and they were very bitter about Ahmadinejad. One of them told me, and this was very characteristic, we don't need Holocaust conferences in Iran. We need jobs. We need jobs, and it should be the function of the government to take care of its population, which was the platform that Ahmadinejad ran on when he was elected. Unlike American politicians, who, of course, walk the walk and talk the talk, you know, during the campaign, all their promises, then they fulfill all their promises. Not never. Same kind of thing happened in Iran. He said, we're going to take all of this oil wealth, we're going to make your lives better. We're going to take care of our old people. We're going to have, you know, cradle-to-grave health care. We're going to have free education. We're going to have free public transport. You know, all the things we're used to here in the United States, you know, that we take for granted. Not. And so he, you know, actually was able to convince, a good number of people that, in fact, this was his plan. Immediately he goes off into the wild blue yonder of Holocaust conferences and Palestine. And this is how delusional and, I dare say, idiotic Ahmadinejad is. He thinks that by championing the Palestinian cause, that Iran will emerge as the leader of the Islamic world, or at least the Arab Middle East. This is not going to happen in 1,000 years. The Arabs have a deep antipathy toward the Iranians, and that antipathy is returned. You know, they're completely divided, and particularly on this issue of religion, because there are two major divides in Islam. Shia Islam, as practiced in Iran, and Sunni Islam, which is the dominant Islam in most of the rest of the Arab world, except for Lebanon, where it's about 40% Shia, and Pakistan, which is not a Shia country, is about 25, not a Shia majority, but it has a 25% Shia minority. So he's totally deluded if he thinks he's going to lead the Arab world. And people think that, you know, this is just an opportunistic thing. He's trying to use the Palestinians as a wedge because he sees there's an opportunity there for Iran because the other Arab regimes are totally collaborating with Washington. That's Mubarak, that's Abdullah in Jordan, and of course the Saudis, who are, you know, the main bankroller of the Taliban. And let me just finally close. That's an applause line, by the way. Finally, thank you. I know, it's getting late, and usually I get a standing ovation when I say finally. I could say, and you hear gasps, and people say, oof, that Woody Allen wannabe. I thought he'd never shut up. You get these New Yorkers going, and they just keep going, you know? They have no shame. One of the propaganda motifs is that Iran is supporting al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda in Iraq and al-Qaeda in Afghanistan, the Taliban. Now, if any of you have just an iota of information about the Middle East, your ribs will break from laughter when you hear this. I mean, this is so implausible as to defy any kind of description. In fact, words even fail me, even though I'm a Gemini. If you don't know what that means, ignore what I just said. There are two major divisions in Islam, right? There's the Sunni and the Shias. There's a break right at the formation of the religion, right when it begins. Unlike the break in Christianity, the first one actually came in 452 at Nicaea when the Eastern churches from which I come from, the Assyrian, the Armenian, the Ethiopian, the Keralite in India broke with Rome. But the big break, of course, happens in the 16th century when the Protestant church forms in England. So the major break in Christianity occurs much, much later. In Islam, it's right at the beginning. And for you to understand what's going on in the Islamic world today, which is 1.2 billion people, and it stretches from Indonesia to Morocco, many, many languages, many cultures. Arabs are a minority in the world of Islam. There are only 300 million Arabs of 1.2 billion Muslims. In fact, the biggest Muslim country is Indonesia, where they hardly speak Arabic, they speak a Malay language. That is followed, incidentally, by Bangladesh, another non-Arab state, Pakistan. India has a huge Muslim population. And then we have Turkey and Iran. Those are all non-Arab states. Egypt is the largest Muslim country in the Arab Middle East. So it's a vast tapestry, a huge mosaic of cultures and fabulous, rich languages, not just Arabic and Farsi, but Urdu and Pashto and Hindi and Bangla and Bahasa Indonesian and, you know, just great, great cultures and languages. The break in Islam comes when the Prophet dies in 632, and there is a dispute in the community, in the Ummah, in the Islamic community, as to the succession. One group argues that it must come from the Ahl al-Bayt, the house of the Prophet. So they're arguing a bloodline, a hereditary line. And that means it must come through Imam Ali, because he is the son-in-law of the Prophet. He married the Prophet's daughter, and he was also the Prophet's first cousin. The other group, who became the Sunnah, or the Sunnis, they're saying it has to be from a consensus in the Ummah, in the community, not from a hereditary line. So the Shias lost, and they have always felt hurt by this. Let me say they feel somewhat victimized that they didn't get a fair shake, that their spiritual leaders like Imam Ali and Hussein and their other imams, they were not honored properly by the Sunnis. So there was a huge break right there. The Sunnis became the dominant force in Islam. About 80% of the 1.2 billion Muslims in the world are Sunni, about 20% are Shia. Now, the other thing I want you to know is, again, has to do with Saudi Arabia, and it's related to the implausibility of Iran helping al-Qaeda in Iraq and the Taliban in Afghanistan. Saudi Arabia has a peculiar type of Islam. It's called Wahhabism. It is characterized by an extreme puritanical streak. It is hyper-punitive, fundamentalist to the extreme, to the extent where they don't even have grave markers, because they don't want anyone to even have a pilgrimage to go to a grave to, you know, lay flowers or to offer prayers or anything like that. And they, within Wahhabism, there is a form of Islam called Salafism. This is what bin Laden preaches. This is what Zawahiri preaches. This is al-Qaeda in Mesopotamia. This is the Taliban. These were the young students. Talib means student in Farsi, and A-N is the plural, so the students of Islam, as it were. They were funded by the Saudis in the 1980s, in the madarsas, in these seminaries, Islamic schools in Pakistan, to go to Afghanistan to defeat the godless atheist Soviets. These became later the kernel of al-Qaeda and the Taliban. See how actions have consequences. The most extreme fundamentalists were recruited from throughout the Islamic world and brought to Pakistan, which is in a bit of turmoil today, if you've been following the news, partly because of these issues, to become an agent of Salafi Islam, this puritanical Islam. Salafi Islam regards the Shias as heretics, as non-Muslims, as their shrines are places of infamy and blasphemy. The word they use is kufr, non-believers. And those of you who are, you know, believe in this non-belief, you are worthy of extermination. So Iran almost went to war with the Taliban in the late 1990s when the Taliban slaughtered Iranian diplomats at the Consulate General of Iran in Mazar-e-Sharif. The U.S. had nothing to say about that invasion of a diplomatic enclave. You see how the double standards work here. What we say goes. So it's implausible that Iran would be aiding elements like these Salafi groups, Wahhabi groups, that are dedicated to Iran's elimination, annihilation. It's simply implausible. So that's an important. So when the Americans are telling you this is what's going on, it can't be going on. They're just looking for an excuse to start a war. Let me end with the words of Shireen Ebadi that I referred to earlier. She has a very interesting view of the current regime in Iran, which is only 28 years old now. I was there in February during the celebration of the revolution, and I can tell you, I never saw so many stage-managed and orchestrated kind of demonstrations of, you know, public outcry. You know, the standard death to America and burning American flags, and, you know, this is all street theater. It's all orchestrated. It's all designed. People weren't into it, I could tell. They were much more interested in the latest DVD, which was then hot on the Tehran streets, The Departed. When I left the U.S., all these new films, they were all being sold, all being shown on DVD, the latest CDs, you know, American cultural products everywhere, all over Valley Asr in Tehran, this big street that which is like an open bazaar at night. So Shireen Ebadi says, the Iranian people are exceedingly proud of their long history and culture. Iran as a country is larger and greater than its rulers and exists apart from any government in power at any particular time. She is saying here that these guys that are ruling us now, they're not long for power. Sooner or later, hopefully sooner in her view, they will be out. And then, but she says, if America attacks, Iranians will unite, forgetting their differences with their government, and they will fiercely and tenaciously defend their country. And then she told me, democracy cannot be brought to a people with cluster bombs. It cannot be delivered from a B-52 or an Apache helicopter gunship or an F-16. It has to be something organic. It has to come up from the bottom. People have to feel it's theirs. They own it, not something imposed by mostly white people, mostly Christian people in Washington, D.C., who don't know Farsi, who know nothing of Iran and Iran's great history and culture. She says, Ebadi, any military invasion or even the threat of one harms democracy. Democracy is not something that happens overnight. It needs to evolve in a peaceful atmosphere, and the United States should not impose it on Iran or any other country. It will be a disaster if it tries. And I noticed when I was talking to her, she was in acute physical distress, and I said, you know, can I get you some water? Do you need an aspirin? You know, what's happening? She says, I've got really terrible sciatica. And, you know, I'm taking medication, but I also read a lot of poetry. And, you know, once I made the mistake when I was in Iran of asking an Iranian, do you like poetry? It's like asking someone, do you like air? Do you like to breathe? Because it's the national passion. You know, people know poems, they know complete verses from Ferdowsi Shahnameh, the great Persian national epic. They know Sa'di and Rumi and Jami and Nezami and Attar, right down to Ahmed Shamlou, who died a few years ago. 100,000 Iranians turned out for his funeral. Imagine that, 100,000 people honoring a poet. You know, when our great poets die, like Allen Ginsberg, 80, 90, 100 people turn out, and we say, whoa, that's impressive. He really made an impact. So many people turned out. 100,000 Iranians. And I went to Shamlu's grave in Karaj, and it was strewn with fresh flowers. People had already been there earlier in the day to honor him. So I really embarrassed myself when I asked an Iranian if they liked poetry or not. But she says she reads poetry. So I said, okay, tell me a couplet. Who's your favorite poet? She said Hafiz of Shiraz, great classic Sufi poet. Hafiz, if there is no justice, then those who are deprived may one day take to the streets and rise up. You know, we could apply this here to the United States, where there seems to be a shortage of justice. If there is no justice, then those who are deprived may one day take to the streets and rise up. So I hope you'll get copies of Targeting Iran and my new book with Noam Chomsky, What We Say Goes. I've done 8 or 10 books with Chomsky. This is the best one. It's really essential Chomsky. I've really edited him really carefully, and it's all lean and to the point and concise and a very, very good book. You know, the so-called holiday season is coming up. It's not so-called. And I tell people, the price of this is 4 lattes, $15. And this one is $12, only 3 lattes. So get as many copies as you can. This is the end of my California tour. I'm exhausted. I'm going home tomorrow to rest for 4 or 5 days. Then I go to New York for 4 events. Then I leave for Pakistan and India. So I want to have a very light suitcase when I go home. Please lighten my load. Get multiple copies and give them out to your friends. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Those were my opening remarks. I have my prepared speech. I've been up all night writing this. Okay, I can see it's getting late. I think Paul wants to say a few words. Isn't it good to laugh? I'm so glad I can make you laugh.
Thank you, David. We'll bring David back for probably an abbreviated Q&A session so that you can buy some of the books. But first, I want to introduce to you Peggy Law. Peggy is the founder of another independent media project, the National Radio Project, that produces the weekly program Making Contact. National Radio Project and Alternative Radio are in fierce competition with each other. Actually, David is also one of the co-founders of National Radio Project. David is on tour trying to raise money for alternative radio. Peggy's going to tell you a little more about that. Please welcome Peggy Law.
Fortunately, I have no prepared remarks. I just wanted to say a couple of things. Some of you maybe heard Darjamal speak just a few days ago here. Last Saturday, Dar and David were in conversation in San Francisco, and it was taped by the National Radio Project and is coming out in 2 weeks. And any Making Contact plays on KPFA at 1:30 on Fridays. But if anybody's interested in getting a CD or a cassette of that program, I have a tablet back there, and just give me your name and address, and I'll let you know, and you can get one. David was pushing his books, and I just want to explain a little bit about being an independent journalist. David makes his money, makes his living selling his CDs and selling his books. David comes here. He has no speaking fee. He has been, you've heard a little bit about his travels. He very seldom has any kind of a speaking fee at all. David is totally immersed in the struggle for peace and justice in this country and beyond. And this is his fifth night in a row in this area. And so I do urge you to get the books, not only because they are filled with an incredible amount of history and not quite as funny as he is in person, but and to hand it out. I bought 10 copies, and I'm going to give them to my families for holiday gifts. And David also pays most of his own expenses when he does it. And one of the things that we're trying to do is raise enough money to at least cover his ticket. flying out from Boulder to do this. And so the hat's got to go around, and Paul has been very generous and in saying, let's see if people can come up with something a little bit extra and be able to cover David's ticket. Because, David, I want to thank you for what you have done here tonight. I want to thank you for your commitment to peace and justice, and for friends for all of us who struggle, and you keep us laughing and you keep us going.